Hello everyone, I am Dr. Chaitali Parekh and it's a privilege to be a part of the Indian Radiologist group. After my master's in radiology, I have done fellowship in musculoskeletal intervention radiology at the well-renowned Sportsmed Hospital and Innovision Imaging under the aegis of Dr. Aditya Daftary and Dr. Malini Lawande for almost 2 years. Currently, I'm the co-founder of MSK Insight and practicing as a musculoskeletal intervention radiologist at the pulse chain of diagnostic centers across Mumbai and Nutech Diagnostic Center, Kalyan. And we'll be discussing on the MRI anatomy of the ankle joint. In this short session, we'll be discussing about the sequences, prerequisites for good reporting, pattern of reporting, and normal MRI anatomy of the ankle. The sequences for a routine ankle MRI consist of T2 fat saturated sagittal images, proton density non-fat saturated images in all the three planes, and T2 fat saturated axial images. T1 weighted images are not obtained as a part of routine ankle MRI done for internal derangements or sports injuries, but T1 weighted images are required for imaging in tumors, infection, and inflammatory conditions. Precisely because, as you can see, the cartilage is not well seen on T1 images. Also, the ligaments have a poor resolution and it is difficult to identify ligament injuries on T1 weighted images. For good reporting, you need good quality images, and if you have a good quality scan, you're more than half the job is done. So 3 Tesla MRI is better than 1.5 Tesla, but good quality images can also be obtained on 1.5 Tesla scanner. Always have a small FOV. If you are imaging the ankle, then just image the ankle and not the entire leg or the foot. Call in the application specialist and set appropriate protocols for the scan. At least get minimum 3 mm thickness images, because with thicker sections the resolution is less, especially when you have to image small and thin ligaments like in the ankle, and obtain the images with 0 mm slice gap. Always make it a point to put a pain marker at the site of pain or swelling in the patient, as this will give you an idea as to which pathology is causing the symptoms to the patient. Remember, we treat the patient and not the MRI scan. Always have a pattern of reporting for any joint MRI and follow that pattern in day-to-day life so that you don't miss anything. The pattern that I follow for the ankle joint is the inside-out pattern. That is, I look at the inner structures first and then work my way outwards. So first you look at the bones, then joint and cartilage, followed by ligaments, tendons, then neurovascular structures and tarsal tunnel, and finally miscellaneous structures, that is plantar fascia and sinus tarsi. The ligaments in the ankle can be divided into high ankle and low ankle ligaments and spring or calcaneonavicular ligament. High ankle ligaments consist of anterior and posterior tibiofibular and syndesmotic ligaments. It is important to identify injuries to the high ankle ligaments. Low ankle ligaments consist of lateral and median ligament complexes. Laterally, you have the anterior and posterior talofibular ligaments and calcaneofibular ligament. Medially is the deltoid ligament, which consists of deep and superficial fibers. Tendons can be divided into 4 compartments, that is anterior, medial, lateral and posterior. So now we will look at all of these normal structures on a normal MRI scan in all the three planes. First, we obviously, as I said, we take the T2 fat saturated sagittal images. Look for bone marrow edema, soft tissue edema, joint effusion, or fluid along the tendon sheath on these images. This will help you to localize the area of abnormality and the ankle joint. And then you can look at the proton density images for the cause of the abnormality. So these are the proton density non-fat saturated sagittal images. This is the scout image which will help you to guide as to which level are we looking at. And as we go from medial to lateral, the first structure that we see is the medial malleolus. Behind the medial malleolus is a thick jet black tendon, which is the tibialis posterior tendon, which goes and attaches to the navicular bone. And these two structures are nothing but the accessory navicular bones. Now, as we go further towards the midline, you can see the tibia articulating with the talus and the talus articulating with the calcaneum. This is the tibio-talar joint. The grey colored zone is nothing but the tibio-talar cartilage. And this is the subtalar joint between the talus and the calcaneum. The subtalar joint consists of 3 parts, that is the anterior, mid and posterior subtalar joint. This is the posterior subtalar joint. And again, you can very well identify the talar as well as the calcaneal cartilage on the proton density images.
Now again we'll come back medially and you see another joint between the talus and the calcaneum, and this is the mid subtalar joint. The anterior subtalar joint is not that important. Talus consists of the talar 2 and the head and neck region. The talus articulates with another bone, which is the navicular bone, and this is the talonavicular joint. And as you go laterally, you see the calcaneum, and this is the anterior process of the calcaneum. Further laterally, the calcaneum articulates with the cuboid, and this is the calcaneocuboid joint. Now, as you go further laterally, you see the fibula. This is the lateral malleolus. Then there are two tendons that are seen posterior to the lateral malleolus in the retromalleolar region. And the tendon that goes and attaches to the base of the fifth metatarsal, this is the peroneus brevis tendon. And the other tendon is the peroneus longus tendon, which goes along the plantar aspect of the foot. Now, we have discussed about the bones, joints, cartilage and few of the tendons. The ligaments are not well seen on sagittal images, and we'll discuss them on the axial and coronal images. But there are three other structures which are important and well seen on sagittal images, and we'll look at those one by one. So again, we are going from medial to lateral, and as we do so, you can see a thick jet black hypointense band along the plantar surface of the foot that goes and attaches to the inferior aspect of calcaneum. This is nothing but the plantar fascia. Plantar fascia consists of three bands, medial, central and lateral. The medial band is smaller. This thick band is nothing but the central band. And as you go further laterally, you see another band that is attaching to the calcaneum, which is thinner than the central band, and this is the lateral band of the plantar fascia. The second important structure is this thick tendon that goes and attaches to the posterior aspect of the calcaneum, and this is the Achilles tendon, and the muscle adjoining it is the soleus muscle. Always look for any osseous bump in the calcaneum in this region, which would indicate a Haglund deformity. There is a small retrocalcaneal bursa in this region. Thin silver of fluid within the bursa is normal. Significant amount of fluid would indicate a pathology in that region. The third structure that is seen on the sagittal image is between the talus and the calcaneum, and this is nothing but the sinus tarsi. Sinus tarsi is hyperintense on proton density images because it predominantly consists of fat along with small ligaments like cervical ligament and neurovascular bundles. Now, because it contains mainly fat, it appears hypointense on the fat saturated images. And any edema or fluid within the sinus tarsi would indicate sinus tarsi degeneration, which can occur in multiple conditions. So we've discussed the imaging in sagittal images. Now we'll look at the axial images. And again, we'll be going from superior to inferior. First, we'll look at the bones. So this larger bone in the cross section is tibia and the smaller one is the fibula. The cartilage and the joint is not well seen on axial images. So next we'll look at the ligaments, and as you go from superior to inferior, you can see thin, flimsy, hypointense bands that are coming from the tibia and going towards the fibula obliquely, and these are nothing but the syndesmotic ligaments. Now as you go further inferiorly, at the level where the tibia is ending and the talus is about to start, you can see thin, hypointense bands both anteriorly and posteriorly, bridging between the tibia and the fibula. This is the anterior and this is the posterior tibiofibular ligaments, which also run obliquely. The key to identify the level at which these ligaments are seen is when the talus has a squared appearance. Now these three ligaments, that is the anterior and posterior tibiofibular and syndesmotic ligaments, are high ankle ligaments, and it is important to identify injury to these ligaments because the management can change from a conservative to a surgical one when these ligaments get injured. Now as you go further inferiorly, where at the place where the talus has a figure of 8 appearance, a thick band is seen between the talus and the fibula, and this is the anterior talofibular ligament. Posteriorly, you have the posterior talofibular ligament. Some hyperintense signal is seen with a striated appearance towards the fibular attachment of the posterior talofibular ligament, and this is normal appearance and it should not be mistaken for a tear or an injury. Remember, the posterior talofibular ligament is one of the last ligaments to get injured in your ankle sprain. Now, as we go further inferiorly, you can see a ligament bridging between the navicular bone and the calcaneum bone, and this is the calcaneonavicular ligament or the spring ligament. Now, there are other few ligaments which are better seen on the coronal images, and we'll discuss it there. Now, we'll look at the tendons. Again, we are going from superior to inferior, and the first compartment that we'll discuss is the medial compartment, which consists of three tendons. Remember, the medial most tendon, be it anterior or posterior, is the tibialis tendon. So this is the tibialis posterior tendon. Now it is like Tom, Dick and Harry. So this will be flexor digitorum longus and this is flexor hallucis longus. Between these two tendons, you have the posterior neurovascular bundle. Remember that tibialis posterior is nearly double the size of the other two tendons. Now, as you go inferiorly, this is the tarsal tunnel, which consists of the posterior neurovascular bundle. In this section, you can see there is an osseous prominence along the posterior aspect of the talus, which is the posterior talar process. It forms a groove within which a tendon is sitting, and that is the flexor hallucis longus tendon. Sometimes there are large posterior talar osteophytes or ostrigonum, which can cause impingement on this tendon and resulting into posterior impingement syndrome. Now we'll concentrate on the tibialis posterior tendon as we go inferiorly. It has a wide attachment to the navicular bone. And these two osseous structures within the tibialis posterior tendon are the accessory navicular bones. Now again, we'll go from superior to inferior, but this time we'll look at the lateral compartment, which consists of two tendons, the peroneus brevis and the longus tendon. The key to remember is B for bone and B for brevis. So the tendon that is close to the bone is the peroneus brevis tendon, and the tendon that is lateral is the longus tendon. Superficial to these two tendons is a thin hypointense band, which is the superior peroneal retinaculum. It is important to identify injuries to this retinaculum because it can result into peroneal tendon dislocations or subluxations. Now, as you go further inferiorly, another thin hypointense band is seen overlying these two tendons at the level of the calcaneum, and this is the inferior peroneal retinaculum. Now further on, the two tendons are seen separately, where the peroneus brevis tendon will go and attach to the base of the fifth metatarsal, and the peroneus longus tendon will go along the plantar surface of the foot. So that is the attachment of the peroneal brevis tendon. Now again, we'll come from superior to inferior, but this time we'll look at the anterior or the extensor compartment. It also consists of three tendons, and as I said, the medial most tendon is the tibialis one. So this is the tibialis anterior. Here it is Tom, Dick and Harry. Anteriorly, the relation is reversed, so it becomes Tom, Harry and Dick. And so this is extensor hallucis longus tendon, and this is the extensor digitorum longus tendon. Remember, the extensor tendons are less involved as compared to the medial flexors or the peroneal tendons. And the last or the fourth compartment is the posterior compartment. This thick jet black tendon is the Achilles tendon, and adjoining it is the soleus muscle. Now, another important structure is this thin hypointense linear band that goes along with the Achilles tendon, and this is the plantaris tendon. It is important because sometimes it is mistaken for a split tear in the Achilles tendon. Now, as you go inferiorly, the Achilles tendon goes and attaches to the calcaneum. So we've discussed the imaging on the axial planes. Now we'll look at the coronal planes, and this time we are going from anterior to posterior. And again, first we'll look at the bones and the cartilage. So this is tibia, this is talus, and this is the tibio-talar joint. Make sure to look at the medial and the lateral talar domes for any osteochondral lesions. Now, medially, as I said, we have the medial ligament complex, which comprises of the deltoid ligament. And these are the deep fibers of the deltoid, which go from the tibia to the talus, from the medial malleolus to the talus. And this is the tibio-talar ligament. It normally has this striated appearance and hyperintense signal within because of the fanning out of the fibers, just like the posterior talofibular ligament.
And this should not be mistaken for a tear.
And deltoid fibers also consist of superficial fibers, which go from tibia to the calcaneum, navicular and the spring ligaments. But the deep fibers are clinically more important. So we have discussed the low ankle ligaments, that is anterior and posterior talofibular ligament, on the axial images. On the coronal images, we look at the calcaneofibular ligament, which is a thick ligament towards the fibular attachment, and it becomes thin towards the calcaneal attachment. This ligament is present deep to the peroneal tendons. It is an oblique ligament, and so as you go posteriorly, you can see it goes towards the calcaneum and has a thin attachment towards the calcaneum. The next is the plantar fascia, and this is the central band of the plantar fascia, and this is the lateral band of the plantar fascia. And it goes and attaches to the calcaneum. And the posterior most structure is obviously the Achilles tendon. So we have discussed the normal appearances of the structures in an ankle joint on the MRI. And this is a checklist of those structures which are better seen on sagittal, axial and the coronal images. But just remember that please make sure to look at these structures on other planes as well, particularly when you are in doubt whether they are injured or not.
Thank you for watching my video. Hope this will help you to understand the basics of how to read an ankle MRI. And if this has helped you, then stay tuned for my next video on ankle sprain, which will be updated very soon.